like sunshine, like springtime, like something's in the water and I'm taking a deep dive. I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it, and nothing in the universe can take this. I can see it clearly now, nothing gonna bring me down.
So welcome to the National University of Singapore Yong Lu Lin School of Medicine webinar in healthy longevity. We have an exciting seminar today. It's the first one from a company working in the longevity space. So we have Liz Parrish from BioViva. Before we do that, though, I want to remind you to use the Q&A chat button to ask questions. And we're also going to go to one of my PhD students, Dong Lu, who's going to give you an update on a recent paper in ovarian aging.
Thanks, Brian. As Brian has mentioned, my name is Dong Lu. I'm a PhD student in Prof. Brian Kennedy's lab. Today, I will be sharing this very interesting paper with you. NAD repletion rescues female fertility during reproductive aging, that was published in 2020. So let me introduce to you the concept of female reproductive aging. This process happens exceptionally early and rapidly than any other organ in the female body system, and it is an irreversible process. It's marked by declining quality in eggs as well as quantity in eggs. As we all know, quality eggs are essential for an embryo to develop, as it virtually provides all the building blocks for an embryo. And poor egg quality has become the biggest barrier for human infertility in developed countries, especially women now are getting married and have babies at a much later age. Currently, there is no treatment for that. There are some techniques developed to circumvent this issue, assisted reproduction techniques, and for example, the use of in vitro fertilization, IVF. However, the use of IVF is very invasive, and despite the woman has gone through so many trauma, they still have a very low success rate of having a healthy baby. What this group of scientists do is they targeted at NAD. What is NAD? It is called nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, an essential cofactor in energy metabolism. Its levels have been found to decline with age, and it has been investigated as a treatment for late life health. Let's see how this group of scientists proceed with this experiment. Firstly, they examined the NAD levels in mouse eggs. It was found similar to other tissues and organs. The NAD levels in mouse eggs declined with age. They increased the NAD level in mouse eggs using the NMN treatment. NMN is an NAD precursor. It is a chemical used by the cells to create NAD. The treatment of NMN lasted for 4 weeks, orally administered at a low dose, just in the drinking water for the mice. Let's see the results. NMN treatment improved egg quality in aged mice, as shown from the left-hand side. We could see that the genetic dynamics as well as egg yield of the aged mice significantly improved. And this was translatable to breeding performance of the mice. We could see that there were higher rates of pregnancy, live births, as well as pups per animal for the aged mice. That means NMN treatment that improved NAD levels in mouse eggs improved fertility and ovarian function in this group of aged mice at their age of about 14 months which was equivalent to a human age of about 47 years, that is about perimenopausal or menopausal women. That gives hope to this group of aged women that wish to have babies. So let's go back to the issues that I mentioned earlier about female reproductive aging. What NAD boosting compounds has achieved is to successfully restore egg quality and treat fertility in aged mice in this study. Thus, NAD boosting compounds can be potentially investigated as a treatment for infertility in aged women, which remains as the biggest barrier for pregnancy in developed countries. And compared to in vitro fertilization, one big advantage of this group of compounds is that they are oral, non-invasive, and can be potentially short-term. As you may remember, it was 4 weeks for the mice to see an effect. And there are multiple alternatives for NAD boosting compounds, not only restricted to NMN. Thus, I believe there's a great potential in this group of compounds in treating age-related infertility. I believe by targeting at the root cause of aging in the female reproductive system, we could potentially reverse the reproductive clock in human, and we could fulfill the dreams of many women who wish to have babies of their own genetic makeups. With that, I will end today. Thank you.
So it's great tonight to have Liz Parrish as one of as our speaker. She founded BioViva USA in 2015 to speed up access to cutting edge therapies that had proven successful in animals. Since then, BioViva, which specializes in collecting medical data, has partnered with Rutgers University and Integrated Health Systems, a gene therapy company. Together, they hope to translate progress into laboratories into treatment available to humans. And so the topic of her talk today is gene therapy to clinically target human aging. So thanks for joining the show, Liz, and we're looking forward to your talk.
I really appreciate being here. It's great that you're having me. So we are going to get right to the program. How do you translate medicine more quickly from bench to bedside? As we know, tens of thousands of papers can come out over, you know, a 5-year period, and very few of the most promising drugs actually translate to humans. So I'm going to walk you through a slide deck that shows you our plan, our platform at BioViva, and how it's actually helping not only our company, but other companies as well. So at BioViva, we believe that defining your destiny is designing it through genetics. And that's a pretty bold statement, but that's really where technology is going. Genetics give us the ability to see inside the human cell and see what sort of genes make us up as people and code for our differences. But it also gives us the ability to manipulate those genes and to create maybe the future human that stays in perfect homeostasis. And that's kind of the goal of the company, is to create a body that defies aging. So what is aging, but it's cellular degeneration over time. And what we want to do is upregulate regeneration faster than that cellular degeneration. So how are we going to do that? That's a pretty big, bold move. But I think that anyone who follows Brian's work is already sold on that. And we'd like to get more people into that kind of thinking. How do you treat the biggest unmet medical needs, which are non-communicable diseases? Well, you do it at the cellular level by chasing the hallmarks of aging. And that's exactly what we're going to talk about here. So our first step through a process of translating medicine more efficiently is patient access. So we have partnered with a company called Integrative Health Systems. It's a network of doctors. It has about 14 doctors now. And they are doctors that will work with patients in high need that need access to technology that isn't available through the regular routes of regulation at this time. We think that human data is the most important data. So we'll talk a little bit later in this talk about mouse data. Anyone who knows me knows that I'm not a big fan of it. When we're targeting aging in the human cell, we're looking at the hallmarks of aging, and that's what you're seeing up here on this screen right now. It's things like telomere attrition, genomic instability, mitochondrial dysfunction. These are things that you're starting to read in most papers that are associated with aging diseases. It's a beautiful opening of the field through all research now that's coming through talking about aging-related diseases. And you know, these aging-related diseases, these non-communicable diseases, now kill about 71% of the population globally. So it's something that we really, it's not just a fanciful thought, it's the most ethical thing to move forward. Here in this slide, what you're seeing is what gene therapy looks like at the cellular level. This is gene therapy being delivered through a delivery method called AAV. And that is essentially a viral vector that can no longer get you sick. It's, you know, guts have been taken out and it's been packed full of human therapeutic genes. And you can see here it transduces through to the nucleus. And this is why we're excited about viral-based vectors. So in the future, you're going to hear a lot of difference of non-viral-based vectors and viral-based vectors. We're interested in the viral-based vectors because they can get the gene into the nucleus where it codes for the proteins that we want it to code for right at the source where we need it to be. And you'll see a list of diseases here. It's because AAV is being used in a myriad of different disease types. And it has its limitations, which we're going to talk about a little bit later in this presentation. But through integrative health systems, what sort of things are integrative health systems treating? This is a slide dealing with that. We look at regenerative therapies at a baseline. So we're looking at multiple mortalities, diseases that that are essentially associated with aging. If you have one, you probably have more than one. Heart disease, cancer, Alzheimer's, kidney failure, all of these things are kind of happening to you, and some of them have shorter fuses. And people over the age of 65 generally have two or more of these diseases. So we're also looking at muscle regeneration. So what does that have to do with aging? Well, sarcopenia is the loss of muscle mass over time, and it is directly associated with frailty incidences and your lifespan. A lot of people don't know that, but in animal studies, animals that are beefed up on regenerative therapies that might increase their muscle mass actually live longer. And we just participated in one of those, 33.7% longer. Kidney regeneration, we definitely want to target organ-specific therapeutics. If we can't regenerate an organ, we can't cure aging. This gives us the ability to look at how gene therapies perform on smaller doses. So they're less expensive type therapies. So that's why you would target an organ rather than trying to regenerate a whole body. Dementia, we're going to talk about a little bit about that, some exciting stuff coming out this year, and immune system support. We have one doctor who wants to start using regenerative gene therapies to treat the thymus. So we're going to talk about a few gene candidates that we look at through this platform, and one of them is called HTERT. It codes for an enzyme called telomerase that repairs the ends of the chromosomes that are called telomeres. This is associated with cell division and lifespan. There have been a lot of fantastic studies from bowhead whales to humans to everything in between almost, about how long they live and how many cellular divisions they have. So we believe that this therapy is a baseline therapy to any type of regenerative medicine. So regardless how you do it, you're going to want to lengthen your telomeres if you want to live longer, better. And there she is, a spinning. The next one is follistatin. This is the muscle enhancer. This gene therapy has been through phase 1 and 2 studies with muscular dystrophy. It did not cure muscular dystrophy, but it does increase muscle mass. So we want to repurpose it from its original target to treat sarcopenia and aging people. And here on the left, you can see a boy that's suffering with muscular dystrophy, having a hard time climbing the stairs. And this is the same boy on the right after gene therapy. So even though it's not a cure, it did help people function much better who were suffering from muscular dystrophies. Our next candidate is Clotho. I like this gene therapy. It improves brain function. There are several studies based around mice and them. They're increasing their intelligence after the upregulation of the protein. It also does other things. So it's not just an enhancing gene therapy. It protects against cardiovascular disease and chronic kidney disease. Low levels are associated with both of those diseases, and those are big killers. PGC1-alpha is the last one we're going to talk about today, although we have some new candidates. And this has to do with your mitochondrial quality. So if you want better, more robust, and more mitochondria, this is your gene. This is a gene that's naturally upregulated when you exercise. And we think that it is an important part of a healthy metabolism to fight metabolic disorder. All four of these genes increase lifespan in animal models. This is a little bit of an old slide. I think it was last year, Maximum Life Foundation, a nonprofit, funded 6 patients going through dementia study. And later this year, we are going to have some human data for you. So right now we're going through IP positioning and the biostatistician is working on the data so that we have some cool graphs to show you what happened after this gene therapy. Okay, so that takes us to the biostatisticians and data science. In order to make better drugs, you really need to know how they're performing. And we launched a kit called the Timekeeper, some people might be aware of. It's an epigenetic kit. We're working with 7 different clocks on the back end. I think 5 of them are available for people who participate now to view. And because we want to know what happens with gene therapies, and we want to know what happens with the general population as well. So we've built a backend called the BioKeeper that's HIPAA compliant and has some GDPR components. And it helps people upload all of their medical data to one place so that we can analyze it and look at it, whether they've done a gene therapy, whether they haven't. And then we want to start making this sort of multi-omics correlation for preventative and precision medicine for the future. So this is a really, really exciting project. This is spinning out into its own company and looking for funding now. I think the business plan is almost done for this company. It's pretty amazing. And there's our compliances. So when you get the data and you start to see how a drug works, this is not just our drugs. Other companies might bring their gene therapies or drugs. I always tell investors, if you're really interested in the longevity area, invest in a company going through our platform. Get your first human data. That first human data drives investment. If the drug works, you know, that's going to get you where you need to take that drug. So what we do on our side with what we learn is research and development. And we've been in research and development with Rutgers University for 2.5 years now. And Brian here is going to be reviewing that paper. And it's been reviewed by George Church and some other people that you know in the field. And so he's waiting for a revision, I know. And so we're really excited about this. And what were we going to do here? Well, we wanted to solve some of the problems that we talked about that I alluded to might be happening with AAV. So AAV that we talked about earlier, that's been used in a lot of different therapeutics now for treatments, it has a packaging limit size and it makes it really hard to do gene therapies. And at higher doses, it has toxicity. That's something we have to be honest about. And so if I wanted to give you the 4 gene therapies that I just showed you, I'd have to give them to you in 4 different doses. And if I wanted to give you a lot, we might hit upon a toxicity level. So what we wanted to do is create a vector that actually could package everything. It could package everything and much more into it. And that's what we're working on Rutgers. And so we wanted to be able to deliver multiple genes at one time. We didn't want genomic integration. We want to have that episome, the benefits of AAV. We want to be able to target multiple tissues, and we want to be able to deliver it multiple ways, thereby reducing the dose requirement and not something that didn't have a big immune response. And so that's what we've been working on. And of course, this is the big one therapy to treat them all. Treating aging is going to be a really complex problem. I think it's going to be multiple genes. I think that there'll be some small molecules in there, and there'll be some sort of regenerative type stem cell therapies in order to keep people really healthy for the long term. But if you're going to do it, you're going to have to go big. Okay, so we don't want to just target one part of aging. We want to target the whole thing. So that is... that is pretty much my presentation. So, you know, through smart genetic modification, we can reverse biological aging and create a better future. We're definitely going to have to set down our risk aversion. We're going to have to reanalyze ethics, and we're going to have to take it right to the point of conceiving of these new genes and these new therapies. And so this is one of my favorite quotes: the size of your dreams must always exceed your current capacity to achieve them. If your dreams do not scare you, they are not big enough. And I'll have to tell you that even though we have not cured aging yet, I believe that we're on the way, and we are already, as a company, starting to dream even bigger dreams, because we want to make sure that our dreams keep us right on the edge of our seat. So that's my presentation, and thank you for listening.
Thanks, Liz. That was great. You know, that raises a lot of questions, but I think maybe what we can do just to start with is try to catch everybody up to speed. So, you know, what got you into BioViva? What's the origin story for this company?
Yeah, so I really didn't know anything about aging or treating aging. In 2013, my son was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And I had spent 2 years working with a nonprofit for the education of the use of stem cells, because I had an interest in the area because somebody brought it up to me. And I said, oh, I'd definitely help them on their project. And I learned about all this fantastic regenerative medicine. Well, when I was in the hospital 2 years later with my son, there were no treatments. And all of the things that I had read about, all of the cures and the potentials and everything else, was not translating to humans. So I decided that I would try to find cures for kids, try to figure out where the bottleneck was. And I ended up at a conference that had to do with genetics. It was Aubrey's SENS conference in the UK, but it had the professor of genetics there. And I thought, I got to talk to this guy, because, you know, stem cells work because of the genetics in them. So how could we help bodies be healthier from what we know about stem cells? And that, you know, that was George Church. And, you know, he's been an advisor for the company since it started. But I did not plan to treat aging. I did not plan to even look at it. As a matter of fact, it was a really kind of quite shocking to me. But it absolutely made sense. I mean, there now it's even increased up to 150,000 people a day that could test these type of therapies, and every drug we look at could treat a childhood disease. I mean, that's huge. How do you expedite, but you meet the biggest medical unmet need. And then everybody gets an opportunity to live longer and healthier, even these kids that, you know, the reality is kids are dying every day. It's just less in numbers than it used to be. It's a shocking world.
Yeah. So that's, you know, I think jumping right to the gene therapy approach is a exciting way to go. I mean, a lot of companies that are in the aging space are really still focused on small molecules. And it seems like you wanted to just like get beyond that and go directly to gene modification.
Yeah, absolutely. Because that's where the base root of all of these diseases come from. So by getting right to the point, I mean, you know, we know that. So when you look at an organism, I mean, when you're born, your genes have so much to do with things going wrong. There's some variables. You might get your genome run and you have a susceptibility, you have a percentage chance, but in the long run, they're everything. And in the beginning, they're everything. You got the wrong genes when you're born, lifespan is short. You got the average genes when you're old, your lifespan from there is going to be short as well. So everything lies within those genes. And you know, like the microbiome and things like that are all supporting. So we need to get it all right. That's why we want to look at multi-omics. Mm-hmm. But your genes play the 100% role at the beginning and at the end.
Yeah, and you know, that it's an interesting question, you know, which genes to target. You started with telomerase and myostatin inhibitor. You know, but there's so many different genes. And, you know, I think PGC1 alpha and CLOTH are also interesting targets. But do you imagine that we're going to end up with 20 different things to do or different things to do in each individual? Or how personalized is the therapy going to be down the road? It's sort of an interesting question everybody's grappling with right now.
It's a really good question. So there's a little, so some things like telomerase, I think that everyone can benefit from. And I got lucky to run into that after I went to the SENS conference. Josh Middledorf hooked me up with Bill Andrews, and he was the person who actually made the gene therapy that I took in 2015. And that is like a baseline that's probably good for everyone. You know, there are exclusion criteria to it, such as an active cancer. We just, you know, the integrative health systems completely avoids those sort of things so that the data is not construed by it. But things like PGC1 alpha, I mean, if you're an extremely thin person, probably you may not be a candidate for it. So, I mean, you would have to talk to a medical doctor. Clotho, probably everyone after a certain age would benefit from it. Myostatin inhibitor, if telomerase works the way we think it would work and you establish youthful muscle, would you want more? So there is a little bit of, you know, anyone who goes through integrative health systems needs to talk to a medical doctor. There is some practicality to it. It's not just like devil could care sort of medicine. It certainly isn't. They don't want a bad outcome. It has to pass their rigor. They won't give anything. Mm-hmm. But already within these four genes, I'm sure that there's some sort of guidelines of who should take what and what you shouldn't take.
So you, as you mentioned, you pretty famously did this. You were patient zero, I guess, and in 2015, or patient one, I guess, since you didn't spread a virus. I'll say patient one. And I think that. So what was the outcome of that? You know, how did you? I know it's an N equals one, but what was your response?
Yeah, sure. So that is a really good question. That's something that I've gone all over the world talking about. We opened up all this data. We asked any university if they wanted to look at the data. It was good. I mean, it was positive. So one thing is my telomeres got longer in a multitude of tests. So I think even my 2020 telomeres were just a little bit longer. Not excessively long, but they were a little bit longer. I think my average long telomeres were like up to 12 kb, but my average telomeres were around 8.53 or something like that. The interesting thing is when you do a gene therapy, you're not going to see, because we can't target every cell in your body, you're not going to see all your telomeres get long. So what we're interested in is your average length and your long telomeres. Okay, so how long are the longest telomeres that they're seeing in a batch, and what is the average length? Because the short telomeres are just an indication of telomeres that were not really affected by the gene therapy, because we can't target the whole body yet. We saw a reduction in triglycerides, and they have stayed low. We've seen, and this is actually, I think, the case with anyone who does a myostatin inhibitor or telomerase, is a reduction in blood glucose levels. And that is probably because it's protecting against metabolic disorder. That's the hope. So you increase your muscle mass and you have better insulin sensitivity, but telomerase seems to do that as well. Let's see, what else? We saw increased muscle mass with MRI. That was cool, especially getting it without exercising.
Did the muscle mass persist? I mean, the reason I ask this is that, and this is true with all the people doing testing longevity interventions, is sort of what's the persistence of the effect. So if you take something like rapamycin, you might not want to take it all the time. You might take it for a short dose and then stop. And then the question is, will the benefits last, or will things just go back to where they were? So how much do you know about how long things persisted in this case?
Well, I believe that our chief medical officer, he did the myostatin inhibitor 2 years before I did. So, and he still has sustained muscle gain. Now, you have to remember the myostatin inhibitor is often given intramuscularly, and those are long-lived cells. So the gene therapy is probably going to stick with the body, you know, anywhere from 5 to 10 years. Or it couldn't even stick longer. I think that that's one of the sticking points right now with the FDA is, are these a one-time treatment for a lifetime cure, or will they need to be redone? And that's something we don't know.
Yeah. When you were analyzing telomere length, you were looking at blood cells, or what were you?
The telomeres?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just the regular T lymphocytes.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting because the world, obviously, as you know, has changed with this whole pandemic, but it's also putting AAV vectors in the news, right? Because the Chinese approach has been to use an AAV-based vaccine. So hopefully that'll get people more open-minded toward gene therapy-based approaches. So
it's actually a really exciting time. So if you're using liposomes like the Pfizer and I think Moderna are, or you're using the AAV, or there's even Oxford Biomedica, I think they might be using Lenti. We're on the precipice of, maybe 4 billion people taking their first gene therapy. And I definitely suggest it. I think it's a great way to do immunizations. And it's what was also looked at for Ebola, was gene therapies to upregulate antibodies. It's a beautiful way to do it.
So I just coming back to that, I think I started reading about gene therapy before I even went to graduate school. And, you know, at some point you were thinking, was this ever going to become a reality or not? You know, and it's nice to see that it's becoming more mainstream, because I think there's a huge potential to it.
If you're watching clinical trials, things are really heating up. They're getting excited. There's a lot of cardiovascular gene therapies and things like that going on. It really is now starting to enter the aging space. Cancer has done well, but most of them have been rare disorders, which is fantastic, like severe combined immune deficiency and SMA, spinal muscular atrophy. But you know, the problem is they're really expensive, and we would like to solve that as well. So as much as we want to use our platform to get drugs through regulations, we want to make sure there's always a medical tourism option, so that there's always a way that people can actually get access at a lower cost.
Just to be clear, is there an option now for that, or is that something? So people can go to where is it being
integrative health systems? So that would be integrative health systems. So BioViva can't give gene therapies. We're a U.S. company. We were unable to solve the problem that we initially started to solve. That's why we switched to bioinformatics and drug development. But companies like integrative health systems can help people get access, and if you work with them specifically, you work with BioViva in the sense that we get access to the data, the pre and post data. There's a lot of qualifying criteria, and there's a lot of work to be done. It's not like old medical tourism. I mean, this is, you know, MRIs, blood work, multiple tests before you even get a treatment, and then you're tied to doing all of those after. You're basically tied as closely to science as possible whilst, you know, participating in new technology.
Yeah. So this is I'm sure there's widespread interest in this. I know you talk about medical tourism. Maybe you could comment more about where you think that area is going.
I'm writing my dissertation on it right now, for my MBA. So actually, I'll have even more insight for you in a few months. But if we want to put things into perspective, there were a lot of things that started outside of the regulatory system where people decided, you know, it's up to us to get this into our bodies to find out how it works. And then with medical tourism, you're essentially mixing that with medical doctors who are willing to step up and take liability because of all the deaths that they have seen. And they want to participate in the medicine of the future. And you're, you know, it's not, you know, this is, it's high end stuff and it's expensive modalities, but where it's going is hopefully where open heart surgery is going. So if you want to get open heart surgery in the US, it's $157,000. You've got it or you're out. You can go to India and get the same open heart surgery with a better success rate. You're less likely to die in India and you pay $9,000. You know, and gene therapy is nowhere near that. It's very quite expensive, but it is that the beauty of medical tourism is offering options to people who need them now. Plus, like I showed you, by working with Maximum Life Foundation, Integrative Health Systems was able to treat 6 patients for free. Then you bring that data back onshore, you show investors and say, let's make a drug, let's go for clinical trials. Mm-hmm. This drug works. The last thing we want is to get caught up in clinical trials, pick the wrong endpoints and sink a drug after raising a couple $100 million. I mean, we've recently seen that. Yeah, it's heartbreaking to our area and it's heartbreaking to patients.
Yeah, it's been a fundamental, I think, problem is that phase 3 failures. I mean, not so much in the aging space, but in age-related diseases, Alzheimer's in particular. And, you know, you mentioned a lot about having mixed feelings regarding mouse as a model. So maybe you can comment on your thoughts on that. So. You can, I work in mice, but it's okay. You can say whatever you want. It's fine.
I think that you know, just as you said before, that a lot of this technology has been around for decades. And really the problem with the technology was not lack of mouse models. There have been several, look at telomerase, how many different labs. We have what's called meta-analysis of how the drug works, and that's what's required. So Integrative Health Systems doesn't say, oh, you have a brand new gene candidate. We have no data except for one lab said it worked. It doesn't work that way. It really is a meta-analysis, has to be over a span of different labs and information that showed that it worked, you know, without coercion, right? So so the mouse data already happened. As a matter of fact, it happened over a decade ago. Now it's just literally the translation of those potentials to humans, and that has to happen at some point. So it's either you wait for me to raise $200 million to see if it works in the US, or we, you know, you can do it for a fraction of that, a 200th of that offshore. And that's what I think is so important. So the animal data matters. It has to be there somewhere. That's why we had to go back and do some, and you're going to read a paper about that. But it doesn't have to be redundant. We should not be spending millions and millions of dollars to redo animal studies that already happened. That's called basic research, and we're killing ourselves doing it.
Yeah, I sort of agree with that. I think some of the animal models aren't done particularly well, though. And so, for instance, one of the arguments I'm always making is that if you're going to study a disease in a mouse, use an age-appropriate mouse. So don't engineer an Alzheimer's disease in a 4-month-old mice and then act surprised when your drug you develop doesn't work in an 80-year-old human. I think that...
Yeah, or give a mouse cancer that it doesn't actually naturally have and then think that you cured it. That's the difference between our little mouse study that we just did. We used wild-type mice and we used old wild-type mice, and that created some significance. But I agree 100%. I mean, the problem is we're engineering these mice to have problems they don't naturally have. if you take a gene away from a mouse, like telomerase, you breed them out for 8 generations, they have critically short telomeres, you can say, oh, that looks like a progeric child, and you add back the gene that they don't have, they're going to get healthier. And if they don't live actually as long as they would have naturally lived, you shouldn't really claim 33% life extension, because they would have died. Yeah, I mean, they were lacking a gene, a critical gene for function.
Yeah, I think using accelerated aging mouse models is valuable only in certain contexts. I mean, all of the interventions we test in mice are in normal wild type mice. We're starting our interventions in older mice, like at 18 months. So
that's what we did too.
Yeah. Well, I mean, a lot of that comes from the initial data that rapamycin worked at that age. And that was actually an accident. You know, the intervention testing program had decided to test rapamycin like all their other drugs at 4 months of age, but they couldn't figure out how to get rapamycin in the food. And so the mice were getting older, and then they developed a system to have stable rapamycin in the food for the mice. And the mice were already 18 months, and they thought, well, let's see what happens. And so it was kind of an accident, but I think it was a really fortuitous one, because it was the first study I saw that suggested that you could affect aging starting in middle age, which is, from a human perspective, that's where we all want to be, right? I mean, it's, maybe you want to do, well, I can ask you the question, actually, when should we intervene to affect human aging?
Well, I think that right now, doing these major interventions, we should intervene at middle age or beyond, when a person feels comfortable with making this significant change. But I think that we will see the best gains if we do it younger. And so what we really need right now is a safety profile on these new therapeutic approaches. And then I believe that these will be moved back like immunizations, you know, when in you know, a couple decades, we'll say, oh, use it younger, because what you want to do is you want to stop that accumulation from damage before it starts happening, because now you've got a real uphill battle. And, you know, a lot of people say, do you want to make a body like a 25-year-old? Well, no, you kind of want to make a body that hasn't been seen. A 25-year-old's accumulating damage, you know, a very young person is accumulating damage. So it's kind of like really new territory, and it probably sounds kind of scary to some people, but hopefully you can think about how that would be for you and own that technology and try to project your future based on that. People fall into time really well. So if you're not aging, you don't need a limit to have a useful life. And even though we're a health span company, we have now just run up against what happens if you make people extremely healthy. Well, if people are healthy, they don't die, right? So they die of other things, but not internal problems with the cells. So it does raise interesting questions there.
You said you have a study first with 6 people that I know you can't talk about the outcome yet, but what are you looking at in that study? What are the...
Well, in that study, brain images were the first requirement, blood work and cognitive tests. We are looking at epigenetics. We always screen the genome of people who participate in that system. Essentially, integrative health systems has a way to just send them all of these kits and materials, and we will often pay for all of those. We look at even their microbiome. And then after treatment, you know, it really is doing all of those tests over and over and over again to see if there is a point at which we see something change.
And can you be specific about the intervention that was done?
I can't be completely specific about it yet, okay, because we're still in our IP development, so we are a company that's for profit. We did use 2 different genes, and of one of the genes, we delivered it in 2 different ways. So in the world of AAV, that means there's 3 different drugs delivered, or an integrative health systems, because I can't say we did it, but we are definitely tracking the study and we're interested in the outcome.
What do you think the best, I mean, just speaking theoretically now, what do you think the best outcomes are going to be to measure aging? How much do you believe in these methylation clocks, or do you think more physiologic parameters like you mentioned muscle mass and telomeres and things like that. So where do you think we're going? I mean, one of the challenges for everybody is if you have an intervention that slows or reverses aging in humans, how do you validate that? And so we're struggling with that with our clinical approaches here. And so I'm wondering what your thoughts are.
I think that's a really good question because, I mean, I obviously like the methylation clocks. That's why we created the timekeeper. It has five different clocks on the back end and two that we can see, that so seven. I think that they're getting really good. So there's an interesting thing to unpackage here. So first of all, we're trying to reverse what we know of biological aging, but then we're also trying to look for what will the future human look like, which could be a completely different epigenetic pattern, right? So even though we're not there yet, we have to prepare. You always prepare for the future. So I think that the epigenetic tests are good. I think the glycan age test is good. I think that blood work can tell you a little. It changes, right, over the day. But lower blood glucose levels, oh my gosh, you know, that's revolutionary if you're talking about anything about risk of type 2 diabetes, which is, you know, one of the top eight diseases now. You know, I think imaging is going to play a really bigger, much bigger role than we thought. Like if we could image a body, now we do MRIs before and after some of the treatments, but if we could image a whole body from youth to aging and be able to use images, that would be an amazing biomarker. Internal images, the brain, the organs, everything people is aging. It's not just wrinkles on your skin. It literally is. We have one image that's, not ours. It was taken from other research of an 86-year-old brain. And this is a person who didn't have dementia. And if you compare it to a 27-year-old brain, I mean, it's a completely different beast. It looks like it's a different species. You know, it's happening throughout us. We should be concerned. So anything that helps us visually understand it, whether it's in numbers, in text, or in a picture, those will be the critical biomarkers of the future.
You know, just on the company side, there's so many companies now trying to get funded, and there's more investors now in the longevity space. I think people are struggling with this, you know, how do we get the money to do things? So what was the secret? How did you get funded in such a, you know, 2015? That was an accomplishment to get money for aging in that time frame.
I would say that probably our key to success and still being here is only take what you need. We have very few investors, and we never had a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And we only take what we need, and we try to create valuable propositions. Okay, so tests, so data storage center, so doing bioinformatics for companies who are doing medical tourism and becoming tied into their program. You know, you have to, so we'd like to get our research and development funded now after this paper comes out, and we want to get the bioinformatics funded because there are two platforms that we created that are showing value, okay? And especially the drug development, that's going to be huge value. But the holding company will always kind of stay private, will live lean, because we deal with things like medical tourism and things like that that are not traditionally fundable because they're sort of on the fringe. And I guess that I'll be able to tell you more about funding after we launch these two companies into their own sectors. Mm-hmm. It's really, I would just say, find out if your drug works before you try to raise a bunch of money, because what we don't want is a bunch of disenfranchised investors who won't invest in the space because of the, as you said, it's a 94% failure rate through phase three.
It's tough. It's scary. So I think what I'm going to do is bring Janjira So in. She's a research associate in my lab. And she's going to ask some questions from the audience. But before we do that, I wanted Jan to just comment a little bit on our new clinical center that we have set up at Alexandra Hospital. And partly because she's very involved in the research and development, but also because she's our feng shui director. She's designed the what the clinic looks like. So tell us what participants are going to see when they come into the clinic, Dan.
Well, the clinic was just renovated about 1 month ago. It was a very arduous experience for me, and although very worthwhile, very fruitful. I will leave the surprise to you when you come over to visit us over at our clinic at 378 Alexandra Road. Yes, you can fly all the way from the US over to Singapore when COVID eventually, when they allow a travel over to Singapore, okay? So currently I'm just supporting clinical research studies at the Center for Healthy Longevity. So we are based at Alexandra Hospital. So to everyone who's listening, so feel free to visit us when you can. Do reach out to us and volunteer for our studies. Thank you.
So I have to tell you, Liz, that right now the first studies are going to be with Chinese ethnicity. So unless you can convince us you're Chinese.
I was just going to say, do I qualify? Because I've got to get in on this. I've done the four gene therapies we have now, and now I need more.
Jan, do we have any questions?
Oh, we have a lot of questions from the floor, actually. Okay, so the first question from Daniel. So why does the target of your aging intervention actually focus on gene therapy particularly? And well, there are actually safer interventions such as diet or lifestyle.
Well, I mean, I think that that's something that Brian and I talked about. So In the beginning of your life, your genetics can have a really negative effect. In the middle of your life, your diet and your exercise can vastly extend your lifespan, but at the end of your life, they won't do anything anymore. Mm-hmm. And so what we're trying to do is, why would we want to do gene therapy? Because we want to address the hallmarks of aging at the cellular level. I like gene therapy because it is the promise of taking one therapeutic maybe once every 5, 10, or 20 years and it lasting with you. So it's not taking a bunch of drugs. And it has the ability, the potential anyway, of helping a lot of people who, even in middle age of their life, who are unhealthy for other reasons, maybe gross obesity or other things, it helps them get up and get active. And so it has the promise of being a very, very much a lifestyle changing therapy that will stick with you, that you're not a slave to pills or anything else. And it, in all of the age modulating lifespan studies, it's always been genes that has it made the biggest difference in a model organism.
Okay. Thanks for the response, Liz. So we have another question from Steven. So he says, I'm sure the most common and biggest question in people's minds is the aspect of safety. It is just like how the public are skeptical about the AAV COVID vaccine, for example. And so what do you think is the way forward to promote confidence in the general public on this? And are there any safety profiles in clinical trials so far?
Yeah, so we can look at the regulatory system, and now there are 5 regulated gene therapies that are considered a one-time treatment for a lifetime cure. So gene therapy is definitely being used in people, it's being used through the regulatory system with promising results. Now, when we talk about safety and treating aging, something that hasn't historically been considered a disease, there's always this sort of, does the risk outweigh the benefit? Okay, so if we're looking at a dementia study and we're looking people at end of their life that have really no future, time is running out, we know that intervening is really important. Okay, and then for other people who might be interested in sort of anti-aging, even though I might suggest it that people get interested in this technology and participate in it, that really is up to them, having the agency and the autonomy to choose for themselves. One thing that I can tell you is that life, as we know it, without modifying our genes, ends up in 100% death. So from there, you have to assess the risk of how many years you have left and how much of a chance you're willing to take on a new technology. So far through integrative health systems, there hasn't been any bad outcomes, which is fantastic. But that is not ever guaranteed. So, you know, we work as safely as we possibly can with people with the most interest and the biggest, generally biggest unmet medical needs, which is aging disorders later in life.
I mean, I think ultimately it's a, the, I think that we would agree the goal is about educating people and letting them making informed decisions. You know, aging is complicated. What do they value late in life? What do they want to achieve? And how do they get there? And that answer is probably different for different people. And right now, they're just told there's nothing to do about it. But if there are options available that allow them to make informed decisions, then that'll give them more control in the, at the end of the day.
Absolutely. And that's really what it's about, is you having control over your body and making decisions for yourself. That can be very empowering in itself. And certainly we don't want any bad outcomes on our side. So, you know, it's as safe as it possibly can be, but nothing's 100% safe. Living is dangerous.
Okay. So, yes, we have one more question from David. So are you doing gene therapy on all the four genes that you mentioned previously in your talk at once, or is it done one at a time?
Most of them are given disease specific. I did have a goal with the company to never give a gene therapy that I wouldn't participate in. So I can honestly say that I have participated in all four. But that is not necessarily for every person. And generally there's a discrimination given for what disease is being treated or what ailment.
Okay.
So the idea then would be to identify the specific features in an individual person that are going bad the quickest and target the therapy toward them. Is that what you're saying, I think?
Right. So like another biomarker we didn't talk about is atherosclerotic plaques, you know, things like that. You know, when in these people, we're targeting multiple things. So if somebody comes in with cardiovascular risk, they're going to have a similar but slightly different profile of biomarkers than other people might have who are, for instance, dementia. We do a huge panel on dementia, even though we don't anticipate most of it moving because the brain is being directly treated. We're not treating the whole organism. So it varies.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So yes, we have another question from Daniel. So the controversy from superseded gene therapy without long-term safety assessment have drawn flags, such as the case in China, where Dr. He Jiankui was widely criticized. Will this affect the investment profile of your picture and public acceptance?
Are we talking about the gene-edited embryos? Well, we don't do any embryo editing, okay? So we're not working in the area, we're working with consent. So when you're talking about consent, you're talking about a living organism that consents to a treatment, and it does not affect the germline. So it does not affect any children that those people may have. So it's kind of like a real difference in the ethical quality of what I think the general population would consider. Maybe the general population was not prepared for Professor He's work.
Okay. Yeah, we have a lot more questions, actually.
We got time for maybe one to two more.
Okay. Wait, let me just have a look. Okay, we have one from AIM, Thai Tip. Okay, so curing aging is actually a fanciful concept, but would this term be misinterpreted as living immortally? So since we can't live forever, how long can we aim to extend lifespan realistically?
Okay, I'll try to make it as brief as I can. We really don't know. If we do something similar to what we've done to mice recently, maybe 40% longer, but that wouldn't be the end goal. So technology we would continue to build technology to completely burst that bubble. But it depends on what you consider immortal. So I don't really get into that terminology. I think about health span and maybe living longer because of increased health span. But for instance, when you telomerase cells, not cancer, cancer cells are considered immortal, but telomerase cells, totally healthy cells that are given telomere expression in dish, also exceed the normal limit, which is considered an immortal cell. So you might be able to play with some fuzziness of terminology, but we don't know how long a person could live. We would like people to live as long as they feel part of the world and as long as they possibly can.
All right, one more, Jen.
Okay. Just ask. Okay, so there's one more from Shoping. So how is the kidney regenerated? What are the strategies? And does it include delay of disease-related or age-related nephron damage?
Thank you. This is something that's going to be very difficult because regenerating nephrons is, that's not a light task. The reason that we would look at something like the kidney is because everyone is slowly in the process of kidney disease. We'll all eventually lose our kidneys if we live long enough. And so this is a project in order to look at one of the toughest organs to regenerate. We're doing a dual gene therapy, Clotho and telomerase. We're using various tropism vectors in order to target it. And we really hope that we can see some sort of benefit with these therapies. It is vastly unknown. It's uncharted territory, but it's essential to living a long time. So we're taking that upon ourselves to do that.
That's great. And I think with that, we're pretty much out of time. But thanks a lot for joining the show, Liz.
And, thank you for having me.
Anytime. And I want to remind people to use the panelists and all attendees button to continue the chat after the show. Next week, we're going to be looking at it more from the investor side. We have Michael Grieve, who's the CEO and founder of Forever Healthy, talking about investments in the longevity space. And as you know, we usually leave the show with some thoughts from people that are going through the aging process. And I want to let everyone know that my son is now at University of Washington and Austin is now a DJ on the radio show. So I wanted to try my hand at DJing. So we're going to leave you tonight with a young new band that's reimagining the Ramones. So thank you for joining the show and we'll see you next time.
A deep dive, I'm feeling so weightless, like I'm gonna make it, and nothing in the universe can take this. I can see it clearly now, nothing gonna bring me down.